Students, this is the third part of the poem Aunt Jennifer's Tigers. Before starting my lecture today, firstly, I just want to tell you all that in today's video lecture, you can hear some background noises. I'm really, really very sorry for that. Please avoid those noises and try to focus on the lesson, as a noise disturbance can be heard near the end of this lecture. That's why I didn't bother to delete it and make a new one. So please, students, just cooperate with me today. Next time, I'll just keep that in mind and it won't happen again in the coming future. And don't forget to subscribe and share my channel for the latest updates. Always stay tuned and click on the bell icon. Hi students, hope you all are fine. I hope that you all had watched the lectures of part 1 and 2. Those who haven't watched till yet, please stop here right now and just go back and visit the previous lectures of this poem. And then after going through those video lectures, just come back to this one. Okay. Please students, I just request you all to visit the lectures in a sequence order. You just maintain a sequence order. Do accordingly and go through the videos and don't skip any videos in between. Until and unless you complete one single chapter, don't move to the next chapter. I think I just made clear the things to you all. Okay. So just complete one chapter and then just move on to the next chapter. Okay. And just visit the videos in a sequence order. Just watch the videos in a sequence. So today we are going to do a kind of line by line explanation of the poem Aunt Jennifer's Tiger, along with a critical analysis, or you can say critical appreciation. Okay, so just not wasting much more time, let's just get started with the explanation of the poem. And the text of the poem will be appearing on your screen so that you can follow the lines when I will be just reading out the lines. Okay, stanza 1, stanza 2 and stanza 3 are there. Total there are 3 stanzas, and just I'll be reading out the lines, you just follow the lines. So as you all know that Adrienne Rich is the poet of Aunt Jennifer's Tiger. She is actually a poetess, she is a female poet. Okay, Adrienne Rich was an American poet, essayist and feminist. She talks about women's experiences in her married life. We had already talked about this in our previous lectures. She has tried to explore the inner feelings of a woman who is living under the dominance of men. Okay, she always talks about the women-related problems or women-related issues and the sufferings of women in a patriarchal society. Okay, so coming to the first stanza of the poem. The first stanza of the poem is like this. Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across a screen. Just follow the lines of the text. Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across a screen, bright topaz denizens of a world of green. Okay, they do not fear the men beneath the tree, they pace in sleek chivalric certainty. Okay, this is the first stanza of the poem. So what does this line means? What does this lines, what I will say, mean, or what is the analysis of this lines? Just coming to the explanation of this lines, the poet, that is Adrienne Rich, is describing a lady whom she addresses as Aunt Jennifer. Okay, I told you earlier, she is addressing the woman as a aunt, your auntie. She is embroidering a piece of cloth. She is stitching a piece of cloth. It could be a tablecloth or a wall hanging. Okay. She has designed it with beautiful tigers which are running fearlessly in the green forest. Okay, So the Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across the screen. Means she has designed the wall hanging or the tablecloth with a beautiful tigers that are running fearlessly in a green forest. Okay, this the design she had made, the embroidery she had made, it described like this by the poetess. The pattern shows moving and jumping tigers all around over the fabric. Okay, the pattern which she had made in the embroidery is showing a kind of moving and jumping tigers in the fabric. Okay, they are bright yellow in color, as the tiger, the color of a tiger is bright yellow. Okay, with some black kind of spots, dots. Okay, so bright yellow in color, like the color of a topaz stone. Here the poetess has given example of a stone. The name of the stone is topaz. Okay, it is also a color. The color of the stone is a bright yellow. Okay, so here the tiger is compared to the topaz stone. The bright yellow color of a topaz stone is compared to the bright yellow color of the tiger. The tiger which Aunt Jennifer had made in her embroidery. Okay. She has described their beauty by comparing them with this precious yellow stone known as topaz. As I told you, the color of the stone is topaz stone is yellow, and as well as the color of the tiger is also bright yellow. Okay. So both the color is both yellow color is symbolizing the topaz as well as the tiger. Okay. Both the yellow color is a symbol of the tigers and the topaz, which is a stone, a very precious stone. She says that they appear bright yellow in the green backdrop of the forest. Why green backdrop? Because the forest which the aunt has embroidered, okay, the color of the forest is green. This dense green forest background is their home. Okay, the green forest that she had made in her stitching or embroidery, this green forest is the home for the tigers, a home of the tigers. Okay, so you can indirectly we can say that the tigers are the resident of the forest. Okay, they are the proud and fearless residents of the forest, because they usually stays there only. The tigers usually stays there only because it's a wild animal, and they are not affected by the presence of men. Here presence of men means presence of hunters. Okay, because as tigers are symbol of a fearless, a chivalric. Chivalric means bravery. Okay, chivalric ka matlab hota hai bravery, sahas. Okay, so chivalric means bravery. As the tigers are the symbol of bravery, fearlessness. Okay, so they don't fear the men beneath the tree. Means they are not affected by the presence of the men. These men can be the hunters, okay, or maybe some visitors who had come to just have a look. Okay, so we all are just imagining that these men are referred to as hunters. Okay, so they are not afraid of the men who are beneath the tree. Okay, the presence of the men are not described that which men are there. Okay, they may be the hunters. Okay, we can just imagine that these men are the hunters, and the tigers are not afraid of them. Here we can sense the contrast of behavior between the aunt and her tigers. So there is a kind of a contrast in a behavior between the aunt and her tigers. Okay, why? Though the tigers designed by her are fearless, but she herself is afraid of her husband. Okay, the tiger which she is stitching or which she is embroidering. Okay, which she is stitching or which she is embroidering. These tigers are fearless. Okay, at the same time, Aunt Jennifer is very afraid of her husband. Okay, so this is a contrast of a behavior of Aunt Jennifer's and her tiger which she had made in her stitching. Okay, the tigers look elegant, shining, and full of gentleman grace. Those tigers she made were very elegant, very shining. They're very, very attractive to eyes. Okay. And full of gentleman's grace. The tiger she made was very fearless, was a symbol of fearlessness. Okay. Symbol of chivalric certainty. They were the symbol of bravery. Okay. So this is the first stanza of the poem. Up to chivalric certainty. Chivalric means the bravery. Okay. Chivalric certainty. Matlab chivalric ka matlab hota hai bravery, sahas. So next we come to the second stanza of the poem. So just follow the lines of the second stanza. Aunt Jennifer's fingers fluttering through her wool find even the ivory needle hard to pull. The massive weight of uncle's wedding band sits heavily upon Aunt Jennifer's hand. So these three or four lines are the second stanza of the poem. Okay, so as we had been told earlier by the poetess that Aunt Jennifer's it's stitching something, she is embroidering something, she is doing a kind of embroidery, okay, with the help of an ivory needle. Okay, in the last class I already discussed this, that Aunt Jennifer is doing her embroidery work with the help of a ivory needle. So in these lines the poetess means to say that here the poetess describes the fear of Aunt Jennifer towards her husband. Okay. कि कैसे वो अपने husband से डरती है Aunt Jennifer, उसको इस paragraph में, इस not paragraph, इस stanza में describe किया गया है. Just in between, meanwhile, I just want to remind you all, I just want to give you a bit information. What is the difference between a paragraph and stanza? As I, earlier I remember that I had told you all in college. Okay, paragraph and stanza mein kya difference hota hai? Paragraph means if we are reading a story, if we are reading a novel, okay, then usmein kya hota hai? Paragraphs rehta hai. Okay, a story or a novel, a piece of writing consists of a paragraph. But when we are talking about a poem, okay, a poetry, okay, then we come across the word stanza. Okay, so stanza means, obviously stanza also means paragraph, but hum log poetry mein paragraph nahi bolke, hum log poetry mein kya bolte, stanzas bolte. Except apart from the poetry, in any piece of writing, whether it's an essay, whether it's a biography, autobiography, whether it's a novel, whether it's a drama, okay, it's any kind of piece of writing, when you just change a paragraph, when an author, when the writer just change a paragraph, then we just refer to as a paragraph change. Okay, but in a poem, when you just changing a paragraph, the change of the paragraph is known as the stanza. Okay, paragraph in poetry means stanza. Hum log poetry mein paragraph ko stanzas bolte hain, and in any other piece of writing we just refer to as simply as paragraph. But in poetry we just refer paragraph change or paragraph as stanza. Okay, so just keep that in mind. Never just say that in poetry, never just mention that it's a paragraph, just always mention that it's a stanza. Okay, so here the poet describes the fear of Aunt Jennifer towards her husband. She sees while she is doing her embroidery work, her fingers are trembling with the fear of her husband. Okay, as she is doing her stitching, as she is doing her embroidery work, her fears are shaking. Okay, trembling with fear, her fears are shaking. वो मतलब अंदर से वो बहुत ज़्यादा काँप रही हैं, उसका जो fingers है बहुत ज़्यादा काँप रहा है. क्यों काँप रहा है? Because कहीं ना कहीं उसको अपने husband का बहुत ज़्यादा डर है. Okay, she is having a fear of her husband and that is why her fingers are just trembling. Okay, shaking, you can say. Okay, she is pursuing her hobby In her free time or leisure time, what is her hobby? Making the embroidery work. Okay, but probably she is still afraid of her husband. Okay, while she was making her embroidery work, she was very much afraid of her husband, because as I told you in my last class, if suddenly her husband will come and will watch him that she is making embroidery work, he will just scold her or molest her or just torture her. Okay, even he can torture her also. That is why she is very much afraid of her husband. Therefore, she trembles while she is embroidering the piece of cloth. Who could scold and molest her? Her husband does not approve her hobby of embroidery. So, her husband does not like that she is pursuing her hobby, or she is maintaining her hobby, or she is very much happy when she is just focusing on her hobbies. Okay, her husband does not like that ki wo apne hobbies ko maintain kar rahi hai, apne hobbies ko wo jaise uska hobbies hai embroidery karna, us embroidery ko, us embroidery work ko wo stitch kar rahi hai, us embroidery ko wo bana rahi hai, uske husband ko ye cheez pasand nahi hai. Okay, her fingers are so tired of working endlessly all her life, it has become difficult for her to pull her needle up and down. So what does it mean? That wo itna zyada apna kaam karte, she is so tired after all this household work. Okay, she is so tired that she can't even pull up the ivory needle. Okay, ivory needle means the needle which is yahan pe agar dekha jaye to ek needle kabhi ivory ka hota nahi hai. Then also isko matlab kind of it's a kind of a sarcastic taunt, you must say that the needle is very light in weight. You all know it very well. Okay, the needle is very light in weight, but here the poet is focusing on this thing that the needle was so light, then also it was a very difficult for Aunt Jennifer to pull up the needle. Why? Because she was very tired, she was very weary. Okay, after doing all those household work from years, okay, bahut saalon se wo apne ghar ka kaam kar rahi thi, she was very much tired, she was tortured mentally, physically. That is was also a reason of her tiredness. Okay, so she was just pulling the needle to do the embroidery or do the kind of stitching work. But when she was doing her embroidery work, she was feeling very hard, feeling very difficult to pull up the needle. Why? Because she was very tired. Okay, and her fingers were continuously trembling. That was also a reason. Okay, and that is why the poetess has told that as if the needle was made up of ivory or what. Okay, कि क्या क्या needle जो था वो लग रहा था कि वो ivory का बना हुआ है, कि ivory is a, I told you earlier, is a teeth of an elephant. Okay, ivory जो होता है वो teeth of an elephant होता है, हाथी का दांत होता है. And it seems that the needle was made up of ivory, and it was very very hard, very बहुत ही ज़्यादा वो भारी था. ओके, इट वॉज़ हैविंग ए वेरी मच वेट इन इट, एंड इट वॉज़ वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर आंट जेनिफर टू पुल इट अप. ओके, द नीडल इज़ ऑल्सो हैवी फॉर हर टू पुल आउट ऑफ द क्लॉथ. शी इज सो टायर्ड मेंटली एंड फिजिकली दैट शी कांट इवन पुल अप द नीडल वेरी इजिली. ओके, एज शी इज डूइंग द एम्ब्रॉयडरी वर्क, ओके, एज शी इज डूइंग द स्टिचिंग, or as she is doing the embroidery work on the cloth, though it's her hobby, then also she is feeling very difficult to pull up the needle, because it seems that the needle is made up of ivory and it is very heavy for her, it is having a very much weight in it. Okay, then she describes the wedding ring which was given by uncle to Aunt Jennifer. Uncle means yeah, आंट जेनिफर के हस्बैंड. ओके, आंट जेनिफर के हस्बैंड को पोइटिस क्या रेफर करती है? अंकल. ओके, So then she described the wedding ring which was given by uncle to Aunt Jennifer on their wedding day. The words uncle's wedding band, you can just see in the lines in the text of the poem, the uncle's wedding band, as the band was bought up by her husband, if it is his still today. Okay, so this band was bought by her husband, and this band is owned by her husband. Okay, whose husband? Aunt Jennifer's husband. And the lady is dependent on her husband, and this also means that this lady, Aunt Jennifer, is totally dependent on her husband. Okay, she says that it is a kind of burden for her to wear this ring. She is still burdened by the weight of the ring, though the weight of the ring is very less. Okay, then also Aunt Jennifer feels that the ring is very heavy and she is burdened by the weight of the ring. Okay, here the weight actually means, what is the actual meaning of the weight here in context, in the context to the poem, a context of the poem. Okay, here the weight means the encirclement or trapping that has fallen upon her by getting married to him. Okay, so this weight, it means the encirclement of trapping or that has fallen upon her. Matlab, she has been trapped by whom? By her husband. Okay, how she had been trapped? After marrying him, she had been trapped in an unsuccessful marriage. Okay, and she has been burdened by the obligation of married life. So after marrying a very rude man, very dominant man, she has been trapped in an unsuccessful marriage. She has become the man's property. Okay, she has been tortured by her husband so much that the wedding ring, which could have been a beautiful gift for her, seems like a burden to her. Okay, so what, अपने husband से इतना ज़्यादा tortured हुई है, इतना ज़्यादा mentally or physically tortured हुई है, the wedding ring, which is a very beautiful gift, okay, which has proved to be a very beautiful gift, had turned out a burden for her. Okay, and she has just become a property for her man, property for her husband. She is just a mere property for her husband. Okay, she has faced so many difficulties in her married life that the little ring is described as a heavy band on her trembling fingers. Okay, she has faced many difficulties, many sufferings in her married life, because it was a kind of unsuccessful marriage with her husband. Okay, as her husband was very dominant, very rude, very ruthless man, that is the reason she was very unhappy with her husband. She was not satisfied at all with her husband, and that is the only reason it created a kind of a burden for her. And this small ring, which is very light in weight, had put up a burden on her trembling fingers, on her shaking fingers. Why shaking fingers? Because she is always in a fear that someday or the other day her husband will scold her, come and scold her, or come and torture her mentally or physically. Okay, this means that ring is associated with some bad experience, of course, in her life. Okay, in the form of a torture she has faced because of her husband's dominating behavior. As I told you all, because this ring, which is a beautiful gift, okay, which is a beautiful gift, which is proved to be a beautiful gift in every marriage, but this small and beautiful gift had turned out to be a burden for Aunt Jennifer. Why? Because the dominance of her husband, due to the torture of her husband, due to the mental and emotional or physical torture or mental pressure given by her husband. Okay, she has been living in a demanding life, due to which she has worn out in her old age. So she has been dealing with a man who is very ruthless in nature, who is very dominant, who is who is very rude person. She is dealing with this man for many years, and that is the only reason she is leading a life which is only demanding in nature, and she has been worn out in her old age. She has been very weak. She has been very tired. She had made herself very weary because after doing all those household work years after years, and now in the present situation or present moment, she is very unhappy, she is very tired, and she has turned out to be a bold old lady who don't have any kind of energy, who is her fingers is always trembling and shaking in fear, and she is always having a fear that if her husband will come and watch her that she is making the embroidery, then her husband will scold her or torture her mentally or physically. Okay, so this is the explanation of the second stanza. Okay, so the rest, one more stanza is left. The rest I will be continuing, I must say, in my next video with the analysis. Okay, so this was the explanation of first and second stanza. Rest I will be continuing in my next video lecture, that is with the line by line explanation of the third stanza along with its analysis. Okay, till then just revise it and just go through these videos, and I'm just continuously telling in all my video lectures that watch the videos all together. All together means what? First go through the part 1, part 2, part 3. Okay, this is a part 3 video. Okay, those who hadn't till now not visited my lectures, till now not visited my this poem, not visited the videos, lectures of this poem, just start from the beginning, start from the part 1, then come to the part 2, then part 3. Okay, just watch the videos in a sequential order so that you can just understand it properly, and just watch the video all together. All together means what? Just take out a day, one day, take out some time, okay, in a day, and just watch part 1, part 2, part 3 in a continuous process. Okay, so that you will be able to understand properly. If you can just do this and then just go to the next chapters. Okay, and this is applicable for each and every chapter, not only Aunt Jennifer's Tigers. This process will be applicable for each and every chapters. Okay, till then just revise it. I'll be meeting you all in my next video lecture with the explanation of the third stanza and its analysis. Meet you all in my next class. Till then, bye bye, take care, goodbye.